We're going to be in Psalm 139. Apparently the Lord wants us to be in the Psalms today. There's much help in the Psalms. Now, it's a known fact that as Christians, we are commanded to do good works. Nobody would argue with that. Ephesians 2:10 tells us, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." In fact, if your life is marked by not doing good works, that will be evidence that you do not know the Lord. All right, 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, it tells us clearly, "No one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning, because he has been born of God. By this, it is evident, it's clear, it's obvious, who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother." So if you live a life of darkness and say you're in the light, you're a liar. God says you are a liar and you do not know him. But is that enough? Are doing good deeds as a believer enough? Does the mission begin and end with doing these good things? Can we see examples in the scripture of people who did good things that was not enough? I have three in mind, so if you want to hold your place in Psalm 139, or if not, you can just listen as I go there. But in Matthew chapter 7, 21, we have example of some people who did good works. It says 7:21, Matthew, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name?'" Is prophesying in the name of Christ a good thing? Would anybody say that's a bad thing? "And cast out demons in your name." Would anyone say casting out demons in the name of Christ is a bad thing? We would say that's a good work. That's a good deed. "And do many mighty works in your name." We don't even know what those things were, but they were many and they were mighty and they were in the name of Christ. Would anyone say that's not a good thing to do many mighty works in the name of Christ? Absolutely not. No one would say that. However, verse 23 says, "And then will I declare to them, I never knew you, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness." In Matthew chapter 6, we have several examples. In verse 1, we have examples of giving. "Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them, for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward." Were they giving? They were giving. And they were tithing. We see in another place in Scripture where Jesus is talking about how they would give and they would tithe down to the mint, dill, cumin, down to the smallest detail. They were tithing. They were giving. But that wasn't enough. In verse 5 of chapter 6, we see, "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward." Were they praying? They were praying. Is praying a good work or a bad work? It's a good work. And they love to do it. People who love to do things, they do them often. So we get this idea of these people who would pray and pray often. Well, was that enough? And we see fasting in verse 16. "And when you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward." They were fasting. Is fasting a good work? Obviously. There's nothing wrong with fasting. Fasting is good. And yet, their fasting, it was not enough. And then if you turn to chapter 27, we see in verse 3, here's Judas. Then when Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he changed his mind. Anybody know what repentance means? The definition of repentance means to change your mind. He changed his mind and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders, saying, now he's confessing, I have sinned by betraying innocent blood. They said, what is that to us? See to it yourself. And throwing down the pieces of silver into the temple, he didn't take it back with him, threw it, left it there. He departed and he went and hanged himself. So in a sense, he repented. He changed his mind. He confessed his sin. He got rid of that thing that was causing him to stumble, if you will. He got rid of it. Last week we heard a really good message about cutting off hands and plucking out eyes. If there's something that caused you to sin, money. We know that he was a lover of money. It says that he used to steal things out of the bag. He got upset when money was being given away. He said, or when the ointment was used. And he said, couldn't we have used this to sell it and you give the proceeds to the poor? And we were told he didn't care anything about the poor. He was a thief. He loved money. When he went to the men, he said, what will you give me? He wanted money. He was a lover of money. And yet, that very thing, which was money, which was his love, he got rid of it. He threw it down. But was his repentance enough? No. Isn't that a sobering thought? Imagine it. We saw this idea of praying and giving and fasting. Imagine you come into the prayer meeting and you hear this one brother who just prays these wonderful prayers. You've been in that situation before, possibly, where you've been praying with somebody and after they prayed, you didn't want to pray because their prayer was just so excellent and just so, oh, wow, it just seemed like, man, they just went straight to the throne and what am I going to say? And you just have this person who just prays this wonderful, heartfelt, powerful prayers in the box back there. They're always the one that gives the most. When it comes to fasting, they're always the one doing it the most. And imagine this same one perishing. It's a sobering thought. That someone can be doing so many good things and still perish. Now, let's make it personal now. How do you know that after all of your works, all of your repenting, all of your fasting, all of your praying, giving, your evangelism, how do you know that it will not have the same result that these people had? You may say, well, I really meant it when I did it. But so did the men in Matthew 7 as they pleaded with Christ, saying, but Lord, Lord, didn't we do this? Weren't these good things? Would you say that they didn't mean it? Certainly not. You may say, but I'm dedicated and disciplined. But weren't the Pharisees just as dedicated and disciplined as they gave down to the smallest detail and prayed and fasted often? When it says that they would cross land and sea to make one convert, would you not say that that's dedication and discipline? You may say, but I repented with tears and changed my mind. But again, didn't Judas give all the money back, confess his sins, and say, I have sinned? So what separates you from these lost souls? I mean, this is critical. Pastor Tim has been talking to us about holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. And as y'all were praying for me, and I was praying, Lord, what do I say? I feel like the Lord has led me to deal with this issue of motives. Brethren, we're going to be talking about motives this morning. Why Do you do the things that you do? So Psalm 139, we're going to be looking at verses 23 and 24. It says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." We're going to look at three things in these verses. First, the request to be searched and known by God. Second, the reason for the searching, to see if there be any grievous way in me. And third, the desire to be led in the everlasting way. So first, the request to be searched by God and known by God. So the first word we see in verse 23 is this word search. Search me. I mean, we have this word search, and it can bring many things to our minds. The Bible uses this word often. Here are a few of the uses of the word search. We got Deuteronomy 4:29 tells us, "But from there you will seek the Lord your God, and you will find him if you search after him with all your heart and with all your soul." Proverbs 2:4 tells us to search for wisdom as for hidden treasure. Proverbs 25:2 tells us it is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the glory of kings to search things out. That's our word right there. Searching for things or people. It can be very good. It can bring very, very happy things to our minds when we lay aside everything and search for God in his word. Seeking for him in the person of Christ and in prayer. Not giving up until he blesses us. Getting this idea of Jacob wrestling with God. Searching for him. This is a beautiful pursuit. Searching for his face. This idea that we saw in Proverbs about searching for wisdom as for hidden treasure. You think about treasure hunters and what they do and how they would take ships and go on these journeys and all these dangerous things to search after something that is very valuable to them. To ask somebody to search for something, it can bring a lot of happiness if it's something worth finding. So doing the searching can bring happiness and joy, as well as being the one searched after or sought for. We're told that God searches for the lost sheep. He searches for the lost coin. He searches for the lost son. To be sought after, to be searched for is one thing. Our God is a compassionate king, and he really pursues rebels in love, pursues after us. I mean, isn't that what happened to us? We hear all these testimonies. We heard two on Wednesday. And you can just hear it. You can just see the bird's eye view how God was after them, searching for them. I love that verse in the song, "All I Have Is Christ." As I ran my hell-bound race, indifferent to the cost, you looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. We rejoice at that truth. We like that, right? Christ loved us and gave himself up for us while we were yet sinners. That's talking about him searching for me. But David doesn't say, "Search for me, O God." David asked God to search him and know his heart. He asked the Lord to try him and know his thoughts or his cares. Being searched is a much different thing than being searched for, right? We have this picture in our culture of a damsel in distress. And this idea of, you know, a dragon or some type of thug or whatever capturing her and taking her away. And then you have the knight in shining armor who goes on his quest searching for this damsel and goes through all manner of difficulty and fights and slays the dragon to find her and rescue her and bring her to safety and love. Like, you know, ladies like that idea. Yeah, I'm being searched for. I like that. But if someone said, "We're going to search you," that would not bring smiles and joy to your mind, because that's a very different idea. To be searched is different. Police search suspects for weapons and drugs. They search their cars, their homes. I grew up in a ghetto, and I saw this all the time when police, they would do raids on homes that they thought were being, you know, drugs and things were going on there, and they'd batter in the door, and they'd go through everything, tearing up stuff, looking for drugs, searching. When people are pulled over and they're suspected of having some type of weapon or drug on them, they are searched. Some of y'all might be familiar with TSA, this organization that came up after 9/11 and the terrorist attacks at the airport. If you've had to fly, you're very familiar with this. They give you two options. Walk through this full body scanner, which sees everything under your clothes, or be searched. It's very uncomfortable. It's not an easy decision to make. People don't like being searched. To be subjected to the inspection of another human is one thing. To have the eyes of a sinful human search you, inspect you, examine you, that's enough to make the boldest of us flee in shame and try to cover up an embarrassment. We like covers. We like clothing. We like to be covered. But again, David isn't saying to the prophet Samuel, search me. He's not saying to the prophet Nathan, search me. He's requesting that God search him and know his heart. His heart, I mean, that's the secret chamber of a man. It's the core of who you are. It's you. It's the seat of your mind, your will, and emotions. It's that secret place. I was thinking about this, and it reminded me of when I was growing up and how I hated when people would come visit us because I knew what that meant for us children. It meant we had to clean the house. Especially on Saturdays. Oh, it was the worst. I thought I was going to watch Saturday cartoons with my cereal, and nope, somebody's coming over. So everything had to be clean. I mean, we had the bathroom had to be immaculate. The kitchen had to be clean. The living room. Anywhere where there was a possibility of someone going had to be clean. But one place my mother never told us to clean was her room. Isn't that true? But why is that? Because it's private. That's off limits. That is a place not for guests, not for visitors. It's a secret place. It's like the heart. David wasn't saying, oh Lord, search my labor. He didn't say, examine my prayer life. Look at my fasting or my giving record. Nothing about look deeply into all the battles that I've fought and all the victories that I've won. Nothing about search out all the psalms that I've written and examine how good I am on the harp. None of that. He rather requests the unthinkable. Search my heart, O God. Search me. Know my heart. The very center of me, who I am. No hiding. Nothing off limits. Every room open. Everything in my soul exposed. I want you to go in there and search me and know me. Just like those narcotic officers, when they believe that there's drugs in a home, they will rip everything apart. They'll look everywhere in the under carpet and ceiling and walls. They'll look everywhere. He's saying, search me and know me. You know what that word know means? It's the same word that's used in Genesis 4:1. Where it says, now Adam knew his wife, Eve, she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. He knew his wife and she conceived. That is the most intimate way of knowing. It's as intimate as it gets. Come into my most secret chamber, O God, and know me in the most intimate way. Know me fully and completely, Lord. He's saying, I want that. I want you to search my will, search my mind, search my emotions, search my motives, my desires. Know me. Not only that, but try me. That word try, it's the same word that's used in the Proverbs where it says, the furnace is for gold and silver, but the Lord tries the hearts. This idea of being tried, being tested, being proven as by fire. Because there's something about these precious metals that in order to see how valuable, what's really in them, you can't tell unless they go through this process of the flame and the heat and the fire. It's this idea if you think, if you know, right now I'm kind of thirsty. and if someone said, hey, I have just the thing for you, the best tasting stuff on earth, and they give me a tea bag. I'm like, what am I supposed to do with this? Just imagine I've never had tea before. And they say, well, what you got to do is you got to put this tea bag in a cup and put some water in it. Okay, I take the tea bag, put it in a cup, run it under the faucet, drink. I say, wait, this is the nastiest stuff I've ever had in my life. And they say, wait. Oh, thank you. Wow. Have not because you asked not. Right? They say, wait. No, you have to put it in the hottest water possible. Because it's in that heat that the goodness and all the beauty and all the taste of what's in that bag will come out. That's being tried. I can say this tea bag contains the best stuff on earth, but unless it gets in the heat, you'll never know. It's proven by the heat. And the testing of who we are is the same way. We are tried, we're tested, we're proven by the suffering, by the pain, by all that we go through. David asked the Lord, try me and know my thoughts. The NAS says, my anxious thoughts. Send me the trials, Lord. Send me the storms. Send me the battles, the pain, the suffering. Try me and know my thoughts. Not my actions, but my thoughts. When pain hits you, you may be one who smiles on the outside, but inwardly, you're cursing God and cursing the one who hurt you. You may be one who appears very pure sexually, but inwardly with your thoughts, it's perverse. Because your thoughts are hidden. But David says, try me, Lord. Examine me, Lord, and know my thoughts. Go in every room of my soul. Know me in the truest, deepest, most honest way. Send me pain and suffering, trials and tests, and know my most anxious, worrying, troubling thoughts. I want to be known by you, Lord. But this kind of presents a little question that I wrestled with. God already knows my thoughts. He already knows what's in my heart. In fact, in this very psalm, if you read the psalm in full, it is filled with examples of this. I'll highlight just a few. In verse 2, he says, you know when I sit down and rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. Verse 3, he says, you are acquainted with all my ways. In verse 4, it says, even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all together. So obviously, God knows everything about David, so why is he asking for God to know what he already knows? Yesterday, when we were out, we saw a man who fought in the Vietnam War. He had a hat on. I started thinking about Vietnam. Vietnam, there were two groups of people who were in that battle. There were those who were drafted and those who volunteered. Now, the chances of you being drafted were very good. And yet some people still volunteer. They still signed up. And it's that idea of voluntarily requesting this. He's volunteering to be searched, to be examined, because he wants to be with God in every way, down to the motives of his heart. He's not content with merely doing good things. He wants to do good things with good intent. He desires for there to be nothing between his soul and the Savior. Because to him, it's his greatest joy to be known by God and to know him. In verse 17, it says, how precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. David was obsessed with the joy of the Lord. He loved God. All throughout the Psalms, you see this consistently. His treasure is God. His desire is God. He wants God. He wants his thoughts. He delights in his law. Why? Because the law is an example of him. It's seeing him. That's why when you sin against the law, you're actually sinning against God. The law is an expression of his person. And you read Psalm 119 and you're like, man, David was really into the law. No, he's really into God. He loved God. My wife knows I love her, but there's something about hearing me say, Michelle, I love you, that stirs her heart with affection. Doesn't the Lord already know what we need and yet he tells us to pray? Doesn't he say that the field is ripe for harvest, and yet he says, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would send out laborers? Lord, you already know that the field needs laborers. You just told me that, and yet you still want me to ask. We get the benefit of that. Prayer is for us. And this request by David is for him, that God would search him. It's a humble request to lay it all out and say, Lord, I want to be clean. I want to have a clear conscience before you. I want everything that I do to be right and pure. I want you to know me intimately and deeply. But there's more reasons, which brings us to our second point. The reason for the searching, to see if there be any grievous thing in me. David doesn't merely want to be searched and known for intimacy's sake alone. Pardon me. But he has another reason for this searching. He wants God to look for something in particular. As he is in the secret chamber of his heart, trying him, testing him, knowing his heart and his thoughts, he wants the Lord to look for any grievous way. There's two elements in this passage, this part right here that I want us to look at. First, the extent of his request. He says, any grievous way. Not major ones, but any grievous way. Some of y'all know that I used to do pest control, and we would get calls all the time. We got rats, we have roaches, there's a raccoon in our attic, all kind of stuff. But we never got a phone call from somebody who said, there's a fly in my house. Can you imagine calling the pest control person and saying, I found a fly, can you come and find it for me? They would say, one? Just one? Like, to us, we understand the reaction, like, that's ridiculous, it's only one. But when it comes to sin, David had the mindset, he said, any grievous sin, anything. He wanted the Lord to find it, even a so-called little one. I mean, much is said today about pornography and drunkenness and murder and idolatry. These are the bigger sins. Yet will you permit even one sin to remain within your heart? Will you allow jealousy or laziness or wasting time to stay in the back room while the bigger sins are ushered out the door? Is judging the heart of another Christian permitted to stay? Does speaking harshly or rolling your eyes when someone's talking to you, is that excused? Does the silent treatment get a hall pass? He says if there be any, not even a hint, not even an echo, if there be any grievous way in me. Secondly, looking at the word grievous, I think is worth mentioning. If I asked you right now, I want you to go look at my car and tell me whether you think it's clean or not. Some of you would say, that's pretty good. Others would say, brother, we need to talk. It would depend. Well, right now, my wife and the kids clean it, so you probably say it looks good. But it would depend on your own standard, right? The one who I'm asking to do the looking is going to depend on their standard, whether or not it's good and clean. David is leaving whether or not it's a grievous way up to the Lord. You see that? He's saying, Lord, I want you to see if there's a grievous way in me. Because I may not see it as grievous. It may not cause me to grieve. But if it causes you to grieve, I want you to find it. And we want to get rid of that thing. You may be saying, how does this have anything to do with motives? Much in every way. Think of Judas returning the silver. Was his constant prayer, Lord, search me as I do this, know my heart. Even as I do this good thing of returning the silver, is there anything grievous about my reasons for this that you can see, Lord? There was much that was grievous about his reasoning because he went and hung himself. He had worldly sorrow. It ended in death. He didn't bring that to the Lord. He didn't say, search my heart, try this work that I'm doing and see whether or not there's anything grievous in it, because he didn't care if God was grieved by it. The Pharisees prayed long, and yet did they pray once in all those prayers for God to search their hearts to see if they're praying, even they're praying if there was any sin in it. No, because they had their motives, and their motives were self-centered. It was about them. They wanted to be seen by others. It is possible to clean the outside of the cup. It's possible to be a whitewashed tomb and inwardly be dead men's bones. Inwardly, think of that, the outside of the cup, that's the action. Inside is the motive, it's the heart, the whitewashed tomb, that's the outside. Inwardly, dead men's bones, that's the motive, that's the heart, that's the reasoning for it. The children of Israel, they all often, you look at it, they were often offering sacrifice to God. Often going to the feasts, going to all the festivals, doing all these things. And this is what the Lord consistently said, I despise your feasts. I am not pleased with your sacrifices. Why? Were they doing it wrong? Were they not putting the animal on the right altar? No. Were they not shedding the right blood? They were doing that. But what did he say? These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. It's consistent. It's a consistent theme that you can be doing all these good things, but if inwardly, if your motives, if your reasons, if your intentions are wrong, the whole thing is wrong. And it will not help. It will not count towards you. It will count against you. Again, they were not asking God to search them, for God to know them and try them and test them and examine them and know their thoughts. No prayer of God, do you see anything in what I'm doing that bothers you? Is anything about what I'm doing, is it grieving your heart, oh God? Because either he's your motive or you are. Those are your only two options. Don't fool yourself. Don't say there's a third option. Either you are your reason or he is your reason for everything you do. So some examples here. Okay, we have the box in the back. It's for those who desire to give. And you say, okay, I have some money. I want to give towards the gospel. And so you write out your check or whatever, and you're about to put it in there, but stop and ask yourself, why am I doing this? Do I think by putting this in there that I'm somehow becoming more worthy before God? That I'm somehow adding to the blood of Christ? That I'm somehow now acceptable before God because I gave? Because many people think that. Ask yourself, why? Is this going to make me more loved by Christ? What's your reason? I've seen this often. There are many men who will behave very kindly towards sisters. And it appears so nice and so pure. But you get down to it and you want to know why. And the reason why many of them do it is because they find the sister attractive and they're hoping that this will get them into a good position with them so that they can fulfill their selfish desires. What is the reason for it? Why are you opening the door for that sister? Why are you giving up your chair for her? Why are you buying her child some clothes? Why? Is it for you or is it for the glory of God? Is it because Christ is so beautiful? He's worthy of my worship, and the way that I can worship him is by pouring out my life on behalf of others. Is that your reason? Or is it because you want something from them and you think this is the quickest way to get it? Why? Even evangelism. Listen, we've seen it. There are people who were even members of this church, or who would come to this church often, and they would go downtown and they'd be in front of the Alamo screaming and proclaiming and pleading with sinners to repent. They would go to SAC and all manner of other places. They would be preaching in their neighborhoods and holding Bible studies. And where are they now? They're back in the world. They fell away. Why were they evangelizing? Was it for the glory of God? Obviously not. It couldn't have been. Their hearts and desires were not fueled by passion to see the Lord pleased. They had their own motives and their own reasons. If they were of us, they would have remained with us. The crowd in Matthew 7, they were walking in darkness and yet doing many mighty works. Why were they doing them? What was the reason? More importantly, what is yours? Why do you do the things you do? This really is a matter of life and death. Why are you even here this morning? Why are you at church? Why do you come to church? Are you here to seek his face? To encourage the saints? to hear the truth about God, to worship Him? Are you here for God? Are you here to love the brethren? When I was lost, I went to church because there were girls there. Some of you may be here because they give free meals after, and I don't want to spend money, so I'm here for the free meal. Others are here because you think this is my religious duty for the week. This is what I do. Some of you say, well, you know what? I sinned last night, and the way that I can clear my conscience is by going to church. Why? We often see people come to church and they don't even listen to the preaching. They come and they're not even here. They're not even paying attention to the sermon. They're not even singing the songs. It's like, why did you come? What was the reason? We've had prayer meetings, and the whole time there have been people who have been in the back, not praying, but just small talk. And again, don't hear legalism. It doesn't mean there's no time to go in the back and all that stuff, but you hear what I'm saying. The question arises, why did you come? If not to hear the preaching, if not to encourage others, if not to fellowship, if not to worship the Lord, then why? And your actions betray your heart sometimes. Why? Was it for some selfish reason? Are you looking for everyone else to compliment you and say hi to you and feed you and give to you? Are you here for you? Is there some selfish, righteous reason? Are you thinking by praying or by fasting or giving or preaching or sharing the gospel or reading your Bible that this will somehow make you worthy to stand before God? If so, then you are in danger. This is a dangerous place to be when you think that your behavior will somehow make you acceptable to God. What is your reason? What are your motives? Unless you rely upon the person of Christ. We heard it this morning in the Sunday school. We sang it in the hymns. Unless it is the person of Christ alone upon which you stand, then you are not saved. Then you are condemned. There is salvation in no other name except Christ alone. Which leads us to our final point. The humble desire to be led in the everlasting way. This implies two things as well. David says, and lead me. To be led implies, I don't know the way. I don't want to go my own way because unless I follow you, I'm going to go astray. I was reading Spurgeon on this and he was saying, you think about it. David was already an old man when he said this. He was already experienced. He had already had so many victories. You read the Psalms and you can see his life and progression and holiness and intimacy with God. And yet, even at this point, later in his life, he still says, lead me. It also says, I'm not in charge. He asked the Lord to lead him in this kind of relationship. When there's leading, there's only two places you can be. Either you're the leader or you're the follower. And Jesus told us often, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Jesus said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Jesus said, follow me and leave the dead to bury their dead. As Jesus passed on from there, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth and he said to him, follow me. And he rose and followed him. Jesus said, if you would be perfect, go sell what you possess, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. And whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Jesus was constantly telling people to follow him. He was telling them, you don't know the way. If somebody's walking and you tell them, follow me. You're telling them, you don't know where you're going. Follow me. I do. David is praying, lead me. Only those who don't know the way need to be led. Jesus tells us, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end is death. You only have two options there. Either you go your way or you follow him who is the way. And if we were left to ourselves, how pitiful would that be? What destruction comes upon us when we think, when we lean to our own understanding, when we do not acknowledge him in all of our ways, when we think, I have this down, I know the way. We stumble and fall in many ways. No, we are needy. We are like blind men who need to be led by hand. Lord, lead me, guide me. I don't want to be left to myself in this. And when it comes to motives, the same thing is true. I don't want to be just left to my own reasoning and my own thinking that, yeah, I think I'm doing this for a good reason. No, I want to submit all of my ways, all of my thinking, all of my motives and my reasons to the Lord. God, please. I don't want to be left to my own convictions. Many people have been ensnared and they say things like, well, it doesn't bother me. I'm not convicted by it. It must be okay. No, that's faulty. No, Lord, search me. Know me. Now, I know that we don't have these deceitful, abominably wicked hearts anyway, but we still have flesh and we still get deceived at times. We still get tricked. No, Lord, search me. Lead me. Guide me. I want to go the way of everlasting, the way of everlasting life, and to know what is eternal life? To know God, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. We need his grace to guide us, his word to direct us, and Christ to lead us. We never come to the place where we say, I got it down. When it comes to our motives, we must not think that we can walk alone without him close every hour. Like that hymn, I need thee every hour. I need thee every hour. Everything I do, every decision I make, please. That's keeping this constant. Why do you think it says things like pray without ceasing? Because we are needy. We need him every moment in everything. I know that I have gone out to try to, okay, I'm doing this for a good reason, thinking in my mind, not submitting this to the Lord, not saying, Lord, search me, really try my heart in this, thinking, yo, yeah, I'm doing this for a good reason. And realizing, wait a minute, no, this was selfish. The reason I did this was selfish. I didn't do this for the glory of God. I did this for me. That's a possibility. Not keeping Christ before our minds, before our eyes, in daily fellowship. Like the song we sing, nothing between my soul and the Savior. This constant communion, constant fellowship, unhindered. If there's anything there, Lord, let's get it out the way because I want to be known by you. I want my heart to be completely open. I want to be an open book in every way. I want nothing hidden, nothing secret, nothing hiding, no secret sins, no secret motives, no secret actions. Everything is before you, Lord, and I want to be led by you and follow you. You think of the life of Jesus. How often did he say, I come to do the will of my Father. I'm doing this for my Father. I'm doing this for my Father. The Father was constantly on his lips. He let everyone know, look, you can try me. You can test my heart and you will see that it is pure, both in action and motive. This is for God. Secondly, not only do we need to be led, but that way in which the Lord takes us is the everlasting way. The eternal way. That way is the highway of holiness that we saw in Isaiah 35. The way is the path up the hill of the Lord. Who ascends the hill of the Lord? He has clean hands and a pure heart. He's not lifted up his soul to vanity or idols. A pure heart. An undefiled conscience. And that's my prayer for us, that as we are striving towards holiness, take James' message last week, which was so helpful. Why am I cutting this thing off? Is it so that I may appear more holy to those around? Is it so that people would see me and say, wow, he's serious about holiness? Or do you care if anyone even sees that you've done these things? It's not about other people's eyes. This is because I want intimacy with you unhindered. I don't want anything to affect my communion with you, Lord. It's not about the eyes of others. It's not about the approval of others. It's not about the applause of others.
It's not about your reputation and what people think about you. This is about intimacy with God, loving Him. Christians are people who love God, who love Christ, who are passionate for Christ. And we don't want anything that grieves Him. Does it grieve you, Lord? I'm watching this movie. Does it grieve you? I'm going to listen to this song. Does it grieve you? As I'm about to say these words, does it grieve you? As I'm about to do whatever I do, does this grieve you? Am I doing this for selfish motive? Now, you don't want to take this too far where you can never make a decision without, but you understand what I'm saying, I hope. I hope you see the spirit of this, the idea of this. Commit all your ways to the Lord. He will establish your paths. Submitting everything to Him. Anything. If there's anything. And when the Lord sees something in us that grieves Him, we want to flee from that thing and follow behind Him as He goes towards eternal joy and love and peace. Because you understand that if I'm here, and this is where the grievous thing is found, I can either stay here or I can go towards the way of everlasting. And the way of everlasting is departing away from that thing. The way of everlasting is the road of repentance, faith in Christ with a pure heart, with a pure conscience. But some people, they desire to keep that thing as long as no one else sees it. Some people say, well, I'm doing everything good on the outside and I have everyone fooled. Nobody knows what's going on inside here. No one knows what's going on inside here. So I'm good. They let me get baptized in the church. They receive me as a member. It's good. I got everyone fooled. But the Lord sees your heart. He knows exactly why you're doing what you're doing. Listen, if you don't know the Lord, you're not born again, you're not redeemed, your sins are not forgiven, God's anger and wrath still remain on you currently, everything you do has the wrong motive. Everything. Scripture says there is none who do good, not even one. Say, but I do good things. But you don't do them for the right motive. And what is the only right motive? It's for the glory of God. And if you're lost, you've never done a single thing for His glory. Everything you've ever done has been for you. It's all been about you. You've worshipped yourself in every way. It's about your pleasure and your comfort and what you can get. And you can tell, because when you don't get what you were working for, what happens? You get angry. I'm not doing this anymore. No one appreciates what I do. No one recognizes what I do. I'm done with this thing. Your heart betrays you. Every choice you make is for you. You love your own way. And all your efforts to be clean, to be worthy, to be holy has failed you. And you're still in your sins and you need a Savior. You cannot clean yourself up. You cannot raise yourself from the dead. You cannot lift yourself out of that deep pit of your sin that we heard about this morning. You cannot stop the enemy of death that is approaching you ever so swiftly. You are not mighty enough to fight against the dark forces of the demonic realm. You cannot stand before the holy, holy, holy God who dwells in unapproachable, blinding, piercing light. You cannot stand before Him and be okay when you will stand before Him on the day of judgment, naked and exposed. Every action and motive, intent of the heart laid out before Him and before you, you will not be okay. Standing in that place, there is only one hope for you. There is only one escape. And today, as you sit in your seat or stand up in the back or whatever you're doing, the all-knowing, almighty God that we've been speaking about, He sees into the deepest corners of your heart. Those places that you think no one else knows, he sees there too. He knows every reason for everything that you've ever done, every moment of every day of your life. He sees it and he knows it. And still, he calls you to come to his table. Even though he sees and knows and is very aware and is angry by all the wicked things that you have done and all the wicked thoughts that you have thought, he calls you to turn from your evil, to turn from serving yourself and sin and Satan. He calls you to stop trying to hide behind your good works because he sees your motives. He knows exactly what you are, and so do you, and you know you're not clean. You know the reality of your soul. You know the reality of your heart. You know you're not fooling him. As David says, before a word even gets on my tongue, you know it. You can't fool him. You can't trick him. You can't deceive him. He knows. So don't lie. It's better to be honest and deal with the reality that's on the table. You're guilty. You're condemned. And he's calling you to repentance. He's calling you to salvation. He's calling you with mercy. Listen, there's a day that's coming when there will be no more of these calls. There's a day that's coming when you have, you know, it's like when you get that phone call and you keep pressing ignore. I don't want to talk to this person. Ignore. I don't want to talk to this person. Ignore. There comes a point where they're going to stop calling. There comes a point where Christ will cease to call you, where repentance will no longer be allowed for you. Think of Esau. He sought it with tears. It was no longer there. There comes a point where you need to say, okay, enough is enough. Today is the day of salvation. Harden not your hearts on this day. Don't wait. He's calling you with grace to lead you in the way of everlasting. He calls you to trust in the blood that was poured from the veins of his son, to trust in his life, death, and resurrection. And brethren, if you've been doing these things, if you've been doing things with wrong motives, repent and pray that the Lord would search you, that he would know you, that he would try you, that he would know your thoughts. Pray to him, ask him, Lord, there's any grievous way in me, anything that you find grievous, not me. I'm not the standard. I don't want to trust my own heart in this matter. I want you to be the standard. And if you find anything grievous, if I search your word and I see anything that's grievous, Lord, would you take it from me and lead me away from that thing towards the way of everlasting life where you are? I don't want to stay with my sin. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way of life everlasting. Why do you do the things you do? Well, I pray you would do them for the glory of God, as I pray the same for myself. O God, O God, there is no hiding from you. And why would we want to? You're good. We heard it this morning. You're merciful. You abound in steadfast love. You are kind and patient. And you call us to repentance. Your kindness leads us to repentance. That's the point. Lord, please let hearts not be hard to this. But let us examine our hearts, let us examine our motives, and more so importantly, let us pray that you would do so. And let us do all things with a clean, pure, holy motive. Your glory, your honor, your pleasure. In Jesus' name, amen.